Bunraku, the classical Japanese puppet theatre. Accompanied by the distinctive chanting of the narrator and the expressive tone of the shamisen, the puppets are moved around in a way that makes them seem almost alive. Their expressions are so vivid, you imagine you can hear them breathing. Sometimes the puppets cry, sometimes they laugh. Their movements are brought to life by the exquisite skill of the puppeteers. Specialist artisans create the puppets' faces and costumes, breathing life into their expressions. The Bunraku tradition began around 4 centuries ago. Until that time, puppetry and musical recitation were performed separately. But once they were combined, they gave birth to a new form of entertainment. Duty and obligation. Tragic love. The ties between parents and children. These are themes that resonate strongly among Japanese people. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we explore Bunraku and the human dramas of this theatrical tradition that continue to capture the hearts of people in Japan.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Today our theme is Bunraku, Japan's classical puppet theatre. And I've come to the National Bunraku Theatre here in Osaka. The word Bunraku originally derives from the name of another theatre quite close to here, where this quintessentially Japanese performing art first became popular. The name of the theatre eventually became identified with what until then had been known as Ningyo Jōruri. Ningyo just means a puppet, and Jōruri is a kind of performance where a story is chanted along with musical accompaniment. These two performing arts, which had originally been completely separate, first became combined about 400 years ago and then became known as Ningyo Jōruri and subsequently Bunraku. So, first of all, let's take a look at what you might expect to see at a Bunraku performance.
Bunraku has a history dating back 400 years. Combining puppets, narration and music, it's one of Japan's most distinctive traditional arts. The depth of its artistry is also highly appreciated in other countries. The National Bunraku Theatre in Osaka is the centre for this traditional performing art. Each year it stages more than 100 performances. The audience gathers in the lobby. A performance is due to start shortly. Rhythmic wooden clappers sound. The curtain is drawn to the side. The play begins. Looking at the stage, a platform can be seen on the right. It revolves to reveal the taiyu, or narrator, and one or more shamisen players. At the start of the performance, the taiyu raises the script to his forehead to demonstrate his respect for it. A single narrator delivers all the lines, providing a narrative explaining the scene and setting, and reciting the lines spoken by all the characters on stage. This is done with a unique cadence and vocal style known as Gidayu Bushi. Now the puppets appear on stage. Manipulated by teams of puppeteers called Ningyo Zukai, they move in a way that makes them seem almost alive. The puppeteers stand in full view of the audience. The audience focuses on the intricate movements and expressions of the main puppets, which are each operated by 3 puppeteers. This is a style of puppetry that is found nowhere else in the world. The chief puppeteer operates the head and right hand. He's the only one whose face is visible. The other 2 puppeteers keep their faces hidden under black hoods. One operates the puppet's left hand, while the other moves the legs. Working in unison, they bring the puppet to life. Each Bunraku story is divided into several acts. The whole play takes a day to perform. But the acts are written so that they can be enjoyed separately. Today, it's customary for individual acts to be performed on their own. The story is reaching its climax. The Taiyu's delivery is starting to heat up. Varying the pitch and tempo of his recitation, he draws out the personality of each character. The shamisen provides an extra level of expressiveness for the narrative delivered by the Taiyu. There are three types of shamisen, classified according to the thickness of their necks: thick, medium, or thin. In Bunraku, it's the thick-necked shamisen that is used. Its deep tone resonates well with the voice of the Taiyu. The same melody played on the thin-necked shamisen sounds too high and delicate. It doesn't suit the powerful voice of the Taiyu, so it's not used in Bunraku. The powerful delivery of the Taiyu, the rich expressive tone of the shamisen, and the puppeteers bringing the puppets to life. In a Bunraku performance, these three elements are woven together to give full resonance to the deep emotions of the play.
This is the backstage area in the theatre, and first of all we're going to take a look in this room, which is where they keep all the heads and the wigs of the puppets. And you can see the far wall there, there's a whole wall full of puppets' heads. These are all characters that have been cast in the production that's about to begin. And once they've made the decision on what's going to play and which characters are in it, then each of the puppets gets given a new wig, or the wig gets refitted, and then the faces are made up and painted as well. For wigs, there are about 120 varieties. The art of Bunraku has been refined through its long history, and in addition to artistic development, there have also been many innovations both in the structure of the puppets and the equipment on the stage as well. Next, we'll take a look behind the scenes at a Bunraku production.
The stage for Bunraku looks very different from the stages where live actors perform, such as in Kabuki. Running across the stage from left to right, there are three partitions. The puppeteers stand behind these partitions as they operate the puppets. From where the audience is sitting, it looks as though the puppets are walking along the ground. Fittings such as shoji screens hang suspended from above. Between the partitions, there are no obstacles to prevent the puppeteers from moving about freely. Out of sight, there are also many stagehands who contribute to the performance, doing things such as moving props on and off stage. There are many kinds of Bunraku puppets. They feature a number of ingenious mechanisms. The head is the most important part of the puppet. There are about 30 different male heads and around 10 kinds of female heads. These are used according to the age, status, personality, and other aspects of the character portrayed. Some of them are quite unusual. This head of a young woman changes into a demon in a split second. In one story, it's used for a woman who is in love and who is so consumed by the heat of her passion that she's transformed into a serpent. This type of head is ingeniously constructed so that it splits in two when struck by a sword. After a play has been chosen, the heads to be used are selected from those available, in such a way that they match the characters in the play. This casting process is a crucial aspect of any Bunraku production. After that's been decided, a small piece of paper is attached to the head, indicating the name of the role and the puppeteer. When the selection process is finished, work begins on painting the heads to make them ready for the play. Any dust and dirt is cleaned off, and the colour of the paint is changed to match the role. Then details such as the eyes and eyebrows are painted, ensuring that they fit the character. The structure of the Bunraku puppets is simple. Each consists of just a head and torso, with arms and legs attached on strings. It's the way the costumes are arranged over these parts that gives the puppets lifelike bodies. The costumes are just as important as the heads. In a single play, more than 60 costume changes may be needed. Under the costumes, there are layers of cotton padding. These create soft, lifelike bodies. The secret to making them look rounded like real human bodies lies in the way the costumes are fitted. This is how we create the bulge of the stomach. It has to be folded over a bit and curved enough to make a slight swelling. For the females, we do the same thing to form the bust. Although the puppets have no flesh or bones, the techniques used for draping and padding their costumes make them look like real people. A pin is fitted close to her mouth. This is used to hold a cloth in. Female puppets are not fitted with legs. The puppeteers hold the hem of the kimono to give the impression that the puppet's legs are moving while she's walking. If she trips and falls, the shape of the knee is made by the fist of the puppeteer. It makes it seem as though there really are legs inside the kimono. Thanks to these mechanisms and techniques refined over the centuries, the puppeteers create performances that captivate their audiences.
And this is the props department. You'll see all sorts of things over here. There's a hat there, some sandals, and a fox here. Look. Ouch! And then in this little cubby hole here, there's a whole wall of swords. These look just like the real thing, except a little smaller. Oh, there we go. Basically, all of the props that are used in Bunraku plays are scaled down to the size of the puppets, which is two-thirds of what they would be if humans were using them. This is the wardrobe department, and you'll see there's a whole array of costumes here which are going to be used in the production that's just about to start. All of the materials used in these costumes are exactly the same as any live actor would be wearing in any theatrical production. They're just smaller, and the motifs and the designs are all scaled down accordingly as well. And you'll see that every kimono, like this one, has a hole in the back. This is where the puppeteer's hand goes through. Now, you'll see that there are bundles here on the floor. Once a decision has been made on which play is going to be produced and which characters are going to be in that play, the wardrobe people put together these bundles of everything that's needed for each particular costume. These are then passed along to the puppeteers, and it's the puppeteers themselves who dress the characters like this. This is where they store all of the costumes. If you come in here, you'll see these look as if they might be. No, these are women's, I think. These are all women's. All different colours and different types of kimonos. These may be men's here, I think, down at the bottom. In fact, great care is taken to make Bunraku look as real as possible. And although all of the lines are delivered by one single chanter, when you're sitting in the theatre, it's strange. It's almost like you can feel the emotions that the puppets are going through. Next, we're going to take a look at its origins and history.
Bunraku was created through the merging of two performing arts that had evolved independently, puppet plays and joruri, narrated stories with musical accompaniment. The origins of the puppet theatre date back more than 1,200 years. Shrine rituals featuring puppets have been passed down through the centuries on the island of Kyushu in southern Japan. This puppet show portrays a sumo contest between the gods. This is thought to be the earliest form of puppet theatre in Japan. In ancient times, it was believed that the puppets were actually inhabited by the gods. Around 1,000 years ago, Buddhist monks known as Biwa Hoshi began chanting stories while accompanying themselves on the Biwa lute. During the 16th century, the shamisen gradually became more widely used than the biwa, and the music became more melodious. Around the end of the 16th century, this merged with the puppet theater, giving rise to Ningyo Joruri. The end of the civil war in the early years of the 17th century ushered in a long period of peace and stability under the Edo shoguns. Townspeople began enjoying greater affluence with more free time. Leisure activities caught on, such as going on trips, cherry blossom viewing, and especially theatre going. However, the government often tried to regulate people's daily lives, and this led to a pervasive sense of feeling stifled. To maintain social stability, a strict hierarchy was enforced with rigid restrictions. Theatres were the places where the ordinary people were able to find an escape valve. In the 18th century, as the puppet theatre developed, popular playwrights emerged. The best known was Chikamatsu Monzaimon. He wrote stories based on real events. Because the themes were ones that ordinary people could identify with, these plays were well received. Three Bunraku masterpieces in particular, written in a three-year period in the middle of the century, remain classics to this day. Sugawara Denju Tenarai Kagami, first performed in 1746, told the story of a high official of the imperial court who was forced into exile and portrayed the suffering and distress of the people close to him. This story of a father who has to endure the death of his son out of loyalty to his feudal lord, drew tears from the audiences. Another play that appeared the following year was Yoshitsune Senbon Sakura. It told the story of Minamoto no Yoshitsune, a general who was pursued by the forces of his brother, the shogun. It also portrayed the sorrows of the Heike clan, the defeated opponents of the powerful shogun. The third play was Kanabe Hong Chushingura. Based on an actual incident earlier in the 18th century, this story of loyalty and revenge has remained an undying favorite in Japan. The main theme is one of vengeance by the 47 Ronin, masterless warriors of the Akko clan, whose pride as samurai drove them to avenge the death of their feudal lord. But there was another reason why this play became so widely acclaimed. It also incorporated a fictional love story. The loyal retainer Kanpei is torn between his sense of duty and Okaru, the woman he's in love with. Audiences wept at the anguish of this couple, who never lost their love for each other, while remaining set on their mission of revenge. These plays were tragedies, about people whose lives were at the mercy of the events of their times. The protagonists had to endure the pain of putting their duty ahead of love. Whether it was the love between a couple or the bond between parents and children. Duty versus human love and affection. This was a theme that resounded strongly in the hearts of the common people. And it has continued to exert a powerful influence on Japanese literature and entertainment through the succeeding centuries.
In Hollywood, generally speaking, the hero always wins. But Japanese audiences have always been attracted to a certain kind of hero who knows that he's going to lose but still keeps fighting on anyway. There's an expression in Japanese which translates as the aesthetic of the loser, referring to this approach to life. In Japanese history, you'll find various individuals who were regarded as heroes, but who never rose to the pinnacle of power. Rather, they were defeated and driven out, but they never compromised their values. And it's these kind of sentiments that tend to underlie the themes of Bunraku plays. As an illustration of this, let's take a look at a classic tale with a tragic hero and the same theme of love versus duty.
Benkei Joshi is set in the Kamakura period 700 years ago. It was a time when Japan was ruled by samurai warriors. The hero of the story is the warrior monk Musashibo Benkei, who is a loyal retainer of the general Minamoto no Yoshitsune. Entrusted with an important mission, Benkei arrives at the villa where Yoshitsune's wife is staying. Because she was born into the Heike clan, the enemies of the ruling Minamoto family, Yoshitsune himself has come under suspicion of plotting against the shogun. The only way to prove his loyalty is to have his own wife murdered. Benkei's mission is to carry that out. He arrives determined to convince the lady to die for the sake of the family. But he can't bear the idea of killing his lord's wife. Not only is she very beautiful, she's also bearing Yoshitsune's child. Although Benkei is known for his forceful personality, he's conflicted and unable to take action. Yoshitsune has been falsely accused, so Benkei has no choice. But finally, he has an idea. Instead of killing the lady, he will kill her serving maid, who is a similar age and resembles her. The question is, will the chambermaid agree to die in place of her mistress? The maid agrees. However, her mother refuses to let her go through with the plan. She tells her daughter that she can't make this decision without consulting her. She explains that 17 years ago, She had a lover who fathered her daughter. However, he disappeared, and the daughter has never seen his face. The mother says her daughter must meet him at least once before dying. Until that happens, she can't agree to her daughter dying in place of the mistress. As she says this, the mother shows the sleeve of a red kimono that her lover gave her when they parted. In the 17 years since then, she has always kept this sleeve with her. Because she can't remember her lover's face or voice, this is the only clue that can lead her to him. The girl is determined to go ahead out of duty to her mistress. The mother beseeches her not to do it. But then, suddenly a sword is thrust through the gap between the sliding doors, stabbing the maid. From behind the door appears Benkei. He then casts off his outer kimono. Underneath, he's wearing a red kimono, one that has a sleeve missing. It was Benkei who was the girl's father. Benkei had been standing on the other side of the door and heard the mother's words. He realized that the maid was his daughter. However, his duty was to save his lord and his lord's wife. So he decided not to reveal to the girl that he is her father. Instead, he kills her. Benkei usually expresses no emotion, but now he weeps bitterly by the body of the dead girl. And for the first time, he holds his daughter in his arms. This scene in which Benkei places duty ahead of his love for his own child always touches a deep chord in people's hearts.
This kind of tragic love story is something that still resonates very strongly with Japanese audiences. These masterpieces of the Bunraku Theatre have been performed now for centuries, but you still find the same kind of themes being propagated even in recent television dramas, and you'll find that Japanese audiences even today tend to prefer tragic love stories to ones that have happy endings. The sense of self-sacrifice is something that runs very deeply in the Japanese psyche, and you can trace its roots all the way back to the Bunraku Theater of the Edo period. I'll see you again next time.
Next time, our theme is Kiriko cut glasswork. We look at the way this craft has been adopted and developed in Japan and examine its glittering appeal. Glassware that sparkles and glints. Gleaming goblets and cups etched with fine geometric patterns that catch and reflect the light. This is the appeal of the Japanese crystalware known as Kiriko. Glass tableware makes a beautiful setting for Japanese cuisine. The technique for making cut glass was originally introduced from abroad. Adapted and refined by Japanese craftsmen, it became Kiriko. The appeal of fine crystal glass was traditionally likened to that of beautiful women. The fragile light that plays across the facets of cut glass fits the Japanese aesthetic. These days, Kiriko is finding fresh applications. Glass artisans are experimenting with new uses, such as making decorative casings for computers. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we discover Kiriko, the tradition of cut glass that has developed a distinctive beauty all its own in Japan.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Today I've come to the Sumida area of eastern Tokyo to visit a showroom that specializes in cut glass. Let's take a look inside. And our topic for today is this. It's Kiriko, or Japanese lead crystal cut glass. You can take a look at the distinctive colors of it and the geometric patterns as well. Kiriko is created by cutting numerous intersecting lines into the surface of the glass, which then refract and reflect the light in a rather wonderful way. The art of cut glass originally came to Japan from Europe, but once it got here, the Japanese artisans began to incorporate their own modifications and innovations. First of all, let's take a look at what it is that makes Kiriko distinctive.
Inside the precincts of the Kameido Tenjin Shrine in Tokyo stands a traditional Japanese restaurant. During the summer months, many of the courses are served on tableware made of Kiriko glassware. The gleam of the transparent glass conveys a refreshing sense of coolness. At the same time, it makes the whole meal seem more elegant. Kiriko goes very well in combination with other tableware and really helps to show off each course to its best. Our customers really appreciate our Kiriko tableware. People like to use Kiriko in their homes as well. For the Ito family, collecting Kiriko is a hobby. They have many pieces in a variety of shapes and patterns, which they select to complement whatever they're eating on a particular day. With Kiriko to adorn the table, even an everyday meal has a luxurious feel. When I'm thinking about what to make for dinner, I'll think, well, this lettuce would look even more delicious on that dish. Even if it's just a single sausage on its own, a Kiriko dish can make it seem appetizing. It really does make meals fun. In Japanese cuisine, great emphasis is placed on the presentation. When preparing a meal, besides considering the taste, plenty of thought has to go into the colors and shapes of the ingredients, as well as the overall presentation. The gleam of Kiriko crystal adds a further dimension to the exquisite appearance of a traditional Japanese meal. There are various kinds of Kiriko. This style is called Edo Kiriko. It was made during the 19th century in Edo, the old name for Tokyo. In the old days, this kind of ware was made from clear glass that was not coloured. The distinguishing mark of Edo Kiriko is the smoothness of the cuts. Viewed close up from the side, the gentle, rounded edges can be seen. They are all handcrafted. As you slowly move a piece of Edo Kiriko glassware, a faint iridescence becomes visible. This is lead glass. When you hold it in your hands, it feels as if it has a coating of oil. Although the surface is smooth, these cuts have a powerful feel. I think that's part of the allure. Over the years, the surface undergoes a slight chemical change. The result is that lovely rainbow effect. This three-tiered container is considered a masterpiece of Edo Kiriko craftsmanship. As it slowly rotates, the intricate cuts on its surface shimmer, creating little rainbow glints of light. Ranked alongside Edo Kiriko, there is Satsuma Kiriko, which was made in Satsuma, the old name for Kagoshima Prefecture. Satsuma Kiriko was produced in the middle of the 19th century, during the closing years of the Edo Shogunate. Unlike the clear Edo Kiriko, Satsuma Kiriko often featured colored glass, usually red or blue. It was also usually worked with narrow, sharper incisions. One of the features of Satsuma Kiriko is the gradation in the depth of the colors, an effect known as bokashi. If you examine the facets of this glass, you can see that the red coloration gradually fades into the clear glass. This bokashi technique is a distinctive feature of Japanese glassware. Kiriko ware is used for various purposes, not just for the dining table. These lampshades are also produced using Kiriko techniques. They're cut with gentle, curving incisions to produce floral motifs. Their designs show the influence of the Art Deco movement in Europe. Even street lamps have been made from Kiriko. The light refracted through this lattice of cut glass gives off a warm glow onto the city streets. Kiriko can also be crafted to form clock frames, pendants, and other kinds of jewelry. The tradition of Kiriko has become an important part of Japan's culinary culture. It can also be found in items used in other aspects of daily life.
This is the workshop around the back of the showroom, and this is Mr. Seki, who's been making Kiriko for some 60 years now. And he's very kindly allowed me to have a go at doing this. This is the lathe here where you do the cutting. This is a glass that's already been cut, and I have to try and do something like the base of this. So I'm going to put this here to give me an idea. He's already cut two lines in here, and I have to cut something on the diagonal here between them. Let's see if I can do something without absolutely destroying his piece of work here. So, in here you can see a line appearing before my very eyes. Wow. Well, it's not as impossible as I thought it might be. Let's see if I can do another one now. Lines here. Pay more attention, I think. It's kind of difficult centering this. I think I've got it a little bit off. Seasoned craftsman would have a way of fixing that, but I may have screwed up a little bit. Oh, どうですかね、ど素人。
いや、素人にしてはね、上出来ですよ。
そうですか。
はい、初めてにしてはね。
Not bad for a first try, maybe. Well, that's how mine ended up looking, and that's how it looks when a professional does it. Anyway, let's take a look now at how the real pros do it.
Kiriko starts with the glass-making process. The main ingredients in Kiriko glass are pulverized silica, saltpeter, and lead. These are mixed together and melted in a furnace at 1,150 degrees Celsius. The glass used for Kiriko has a relatively high lead content. The molten glass is placed in a mold. Air is blown into it, and then the glass is severed. A second type of glass is then placed on top of the glass left inside the mold. This creates a vessel composed of layers of clear and colored glass. The next stage is to cut it. This is the process by which the pattern is incised into the glass. Nowadays, the cutting process is done with rotating disc-shaped grinding wheels. Wherever the edge of the grinding wheel comes into contact with the glass, it scrapes away some of the surface. As it grinds away the outer layer of colored glass, the inner layer of clear glass appears. This is how the craftsmen create their complex decorative patterns. There are industrial diamonds embedded in the cutting edges of the grinding wheels, which make them hard enough to strip away glass. The alignment and depth of each incision must be precise to the millimeter. This requires the skill of artisans with long years of experience. A finished Kiriko dish. The geometric pattern that's been incised into the design is a traditional octagonal basket weave motif. It's the intricacy of the craftsman's incisions that gives Kiriko ware its alluring glitter. Satsuma Kiriko is known for its vibrant colors. It also boasts the distinctively Japanese technique of bokashi, subtle shadings of color. The secret of this Satsuma-style bokashi effect was that when the colored overlay glass was added, it wasn't done in a mold. Instead, the craftsman applied the molten glass directly. This produced vessels that had thicker surface layers. The difference is clear when seen in cross-section. The vessel on the right was made with layers of clear and colored glass fused inside a mold. On the left, the colored glass has been overlaid manually in the Satsuma Kiriko style, producing a thicker outer layer. This layer of colored glass is then ground away. A range of gradations can be achieved by varying the angle at which the cuts are made. The grinder cuts through the colored layer of glass on the outside into the clear layer underneath. The further the grinder penetrates, the lighter the color that is exposed. It's this gradation that appears in the cutting process which creates the bokashi effect. This Satsuma Kiriko bowl was made in the middle of the 19th century. The cuts that form the checkerboard pattern show off the bokashi effect. These subtle gradations imbue the vessel with a refined elegance. It's thanks to the exquisite skills of the craftsman that Kiriko derives its soft, glittering beauty.
There's an exhibition of Satsuma Kiriko taking place here, so let's go inside and take a look. Glass was originally introduced to Japan through Nagasaki, but the first domestic production of lead crystal glass was made in Edo, the shogun's capital. We have a few examples here of European cut glass. And then, starting here, here's some Edo Kiriko. If you compare it with the European glass, the European one has a much sharper look to it. The Edo Kiriko is a softer kind of line, and it's that soft gentleness which gives it its allure. Satsuma Kiriko ware was originally produced by craftsmen who were invited to move from Edo to the Satsuma domain in the far southwest of Japan. And the colors, this deep wine red and indigo blue, are representative of the style. One of the greatest characteristics of Satsuma Kiriko is what's known as bokashi, or gradation. It's seen to great effect in this piece here. It's almost like a watercolor wash, as if some red ink had been dissolved in water. This gradation effect is something the Japanese seem to have an affinity for. You'll see similar things in the prints of Hiroshige, for example, also in kimono design. And even in modern Japan, you'll see it even in the shirt that I'm wearing now. Let's move on and take a look at the origins of Kiriko and how it developed in Japan.
Glassware was first introduced to Japan in ancient times. In the old capital, Nara, the Shosoin treasure house includes in its collection a cut glass bowl thought to have been made in Persia in the 6th century. The bowl stands about 8 centimeters high. Its surface is cut in the traditional six-sided turtleback pattern. It was carried from Persia to China and then on to Japan. In those days, imported glass was extremely rare and precious. It was not until the middle of the 16th century that European glass arrived in Japan in significant quantities. The Jesuit missionary, Francis Xavier, presented items made of glass, including eyeglasses, as gifts for Japan's feudal lords. Under the Edo shogunate, Nagasaki was Japan's sole gateway to the outside world. It was here that glassmaking was introduced from China, and from the 18th century it started to be produced in Japan. Known as bidoro, from the Portuguese word vidro, glass produced at that time was made by the glass-blowing method. Its beauty captivated the people of Japan. This woodblock print shows a glass cellar during the Edo period. The shopkeeper can be seen removing a glass vessel from a box. In the front, various smaller bottles are displayed. This is an indication that the use of glass was becoming more widespread. With their delicate appearance and translucent color, glass objects became synonymous with beauty. They were even compared to beautiful women. This woodblock print by the renowned ukiyo-e artist Utamaro is one of a series of pictures of notable beauties. A courtesan dressed in kimono is blowing into a glass toy called a poppin. This picture, combining the motif of glassware with female beauty, was very popular. At that time, European cut glass was being imported into Japan by Dutch merchants, who had a monopoly on Western trade with Japan. As a result, the Japanese word for cut glass was giamang, a corruption of the Dutch word for diamond. These giamang pieces come from Bohemia. Grinding wheels were already being used in Europe to create sharp linear designs. The boundaries between the coloured glass layer and the clear glass were also very distinct. Japanese artisans set out to replicate this type of cut glass. This workshop has recreated the manufacturing methods used at that time. Because there were no grinding wheels in Edo, rods of iron and wood had to be used instead. An abrasive slurry was applied to the glass as the artisan carefully ground incisions into it. Grinding glass without any mechanical assistance was a task that required long perseverance. Here is a piece of Edo Kiriko glassware made at that time. Compared to the imported European lead crystal, the cuts are more rounded. Since Japanese Kiriko was worked by hand rather than with machines, it acquired a distinctive soft-edged quality. Glassmaking was still in its infancy in Japan, and Kiriko ware was brittle and easily broken. This kind of crystal ware was still a luxury well beyond the reach of ordinary people. Cutting glass this way produced items that had soft edges and were fragile. This dovetailed well with the prevailing aesthetic sense in Japan. For the people of Edo, glassware like this must have seemed incredibly beautiful and at the same time very fragile. That made them extremely fond of glass objects, even more than people today. The second half of the 19th century saw the end of the shogunate and the start of a period of rapid modernization in Japan. Factories were set up for the mass production of glass, and its use soon spread, becoming an integral part of life for people around the country. The early decades of the 20th century saw numerous Western influences spread into Japan, such as the Art Deco movement. These spawned numerous variations in the applications and designs for Kiriko. But despite these new trends, glassware in Japan continued to reflect the gentle aesthetic of Edo Kiriko. This piece was made in the 1930s. In terms of design as well, it could be said that the Japanese sensibility is reflected in the craftsmanship of the artisans, in the way they made their incisions in the glass. When you pick up these objects in your hand to admire them, you can feel the incisions are smooth and gentle. Even though various techniques and styles have been introduced from abroad over the years, the craft of Kiriko that developed in Japan has preserved its distinctive, gentle quality.
As we just saw in the video, Japan's glassmaking has made huge strides since the second half of the 19th century. Up to that time, Satsuma Kiriko was largely considered a high-end luxury product. In fact, Satsuma Kiriko was only produced for a period of less than 20 years in the mid-19th century. However, the level of craftsmanship was extremely high. Take a look at these are little miniature Kiriko items created for a dolls festival display. The level of the detail is so meticulous, it's really quite amazing. The Japanese are masters of taking elements from foreign cultures and then adapting them to their own use, and Kiriko is a classic example of that. That ability to adapt is still at work, as we're about to see.
The city of Hagi in Yamaguchi Prefecture was another center of Kiriko production during the 19th century. For just a short time, as the Edo shogunate came to a close in the middle of the century, cut glass work known as Hagi Kiriko was made there. But it never achieved the level of prominence enjoyed by the Satsuma or Edo styles. It was soon totally forgotten, even by local people. But one man has unearthed that lost history and is striving to re-establish the Kiriko of Hagi. His name is Kotaro Fujita. Fujita's aim is to make Hagi Kiriko in a way that reflects the local area. He was determined to produce glass using the quartz basalt rock that's quarried in the area and which is used for building walls and other structures. Quartz basalt contains high levels of potassium and can be used to make a hard type of glass called potash glass. The quartz basalt that comes from Hagi also has a lot of iron in it. This imparts a distinctive pale green color to the glass made from this rock. The green tinged glass then has to be cut by hand. Because of its hardness, the design is rendered using shallow incisions. Unlike the soft lead glass of Edo Kiriko and Satsuma Kiriko, our glass is hard. But we concentrate on trying to cut our pieces in a way that gives them a soft feel. Here's an example of the reborn Hagi Kiriko. The glass has a distinct pale green tinge and it's cut with shallow incisions. It's decorated with floral motifs, which makes it rather different from other styles of Kiriko. Hagi Kiriko, once consigned to a dusty corner in the history of Japanese glasswork, has been resurrected through the skill and passion of Fujita and his team. Tokyo is where the craft of Edo Kiriko was born. Here, craftsman Kenji Kumakura is taking the tradition of Kiriko in bold new directions. He's creating a glass casing for a personal computer. Even people who don't know about Kiriko are likely to know about computers. Working with modern-day electronic equipment like this is the perfect way to generate greater awareness of this traditional craft. Kumakura has cut an intricate design into the casing. I thought it would be interesting to apply traditional craftsmanship to a computer, so I made this Kiriko computer casing. Kiriko may be a traditional craft, but it has to keep in step with the times. That's why I decided to create it. Kiriko has always been sustained by innovation, and great efforts are continuing these days to keep it relevant to contemporary life.
As I mentioned earlier on, Satsuma Kiriko was originally only produced for a period of about a dozen years, but there are new initiatives now taking place. About 20 years ago, a movement was launched to revive the craft, and in addition to the classic red, blue, green and yellow colors, new ones such as purple have also been added. There are also a growing number of young people starting to come into the craft as apprentices. A number of Japanese traditional crafts are actually struggling because they're unable to find young people to follow on in the footsteps of the current generation of master craftsmen. In that sense, Kiriko is a little unusual, but it's comforting to know that at least one traditional Japanese craft has a bright future ahead of it. I'll see you again next time.
Next edition of Begin Japanology, our theme is sushi. We will be looking at the origins of this globally popular food and how it developed into its present form.